Today we're going to explore one of my favorite medieval manuscripts, which goes by the name of the Vienna Dioscurides. This 1500-year-old manuscript teaches us not only about the important role of women within early Byzantine society, but also about the rich ancient lore of medicinal plants. What do we know about this manuscript's beginnings? Our best clues are on this page, in which we see the aristocratic woman, Anicia Juliana, sitting resplendently at the center, with symbolic figures encircling her, called personifications. These give us clues about her public image. The personification of gratitude for the arts kneels at her feet, and then that figure with the gold coins on their lap is the figure of magnanimity. The personification of prudence holds a book, emphasizing Anicia's learning. Thus we learn she's supposed to be thought of as generous and learned. But another aspect of this woman's public identity is signaled in the outer spandrels of the circle, where adorable putti work as masons and carpenters. Thus we learn that this woman was also famous for her building projects. Indeed, one church she built in Constantinople, the Church of St. Palaiotis, was so gorgeous that centuries later, parts of it were hauled back to Venice by the Fourth Crusaders to adorn the area of the Church of San Marco, leaving just a few fragments behind to be seen in Istanbul today. Anicia Juliana was known as a patron of the arts and for her learning. Scholars dispute whether she originally commissioned this manuscript or whether it was given to her as a lavish present. But either way, we know this medical text belonged to her. As an exceptionally well-illuminated text, no doubt it was highly treasured by this aristocratic woman. So let's explore more of what she would have viewed back when she first received it in the 6th century. This is Dioscurides, the author of the main text in this manuscript, De Materia Medica. Dioscurides was a first century Roman army physician, and his work continued to be an important source of medicinal plant usage all the way until the Renaissance. Here you see a plant being drawn. So that's part of the practical nature of this manuscript. Women in pre-modern households were often responsible for families' medical treatment. Herbal lore was part of this tradition that passed from antiquity into early medieval Byzantine practice. So that also made this a particularly suitable text for a learned woman like Anicia Juliana. This illumination depicts other famous physicians from antiquity, with Galen in the center in a big chair. He's very famous. Nicander, who wrote a treatise on snake bites, holds out a plant in his hand to tempt the snake. See that in the lower right. Now let's dive into the heart of the manuscript and see what Dioscurides has to teach us about how to use medicinal plants, although please don't try this at home. This folio showing a violet plant interests me on several levels. It's worth taking a moment just to appreciate what a beautiful rendering it is. Moreover, see how it's quite naturalistic. You could imagine someone using this representation to actually identify a plant that they were trying to find to help with a specific remedy. Dioscurides claims that violet, quote, has a cooling faculty, helps a burning stomach and the inflammation of the eyes. And they say that the purple part of the flower does help the epilepsies that are upon children, end quote. These alleged healing properties of the violet are found in other ancient sources like Pliny's Natural History, but it's really in this text by Dioscurides that we have the most common conduit through which this body of knowledge passed into the Renaissance and later. Now, Dioscurides wrote the text in Greek, and that's the main language in this manuscript, but do you notice the Arabic text written both above and below the violet plant? These translations and notes throughout the manuscript tell us that at some point it was used by an Arabic reader. It's not surprising because there were extensive interconnections between the medieval Byzantine and Islamic worlds, especially for scientific learning. Dioscurides was such an important source that we have quite a few other copies of the same text in other medieval manuscripts. This 7th century copy is in Naples, and the 10th century version is in the Morgan Library in New York. Comparing these two versions of the blackberry from two different Dioscurides manuscripts, we see that in the Vienna copy, every plant has its own page. And that's just another marker of how luxurious it was. Another detail I see when looking at this blackberry plant is the style of rendering. It's really different from the classicizing naturalism of the violet plant in the same manuscript. This eclectic range of styles is in fact typical in early Byzantine art. We find some works that are anchored in the classical past, like the violet plant, but then there are others that have more ties to medieval stylistic abstraction, like the blackberry plant. By the way, in case you were wondering, Dioscurides recommends blackberry for hair dye, halting menstruation, and strengthening gums. Cannabis sativa is the same plant that became legal here in Oregon and other states in recent years. Dioscurides recommends it for making rope and helping with ear pain. Compare how it was depicted in a 19th century German handbook of medicinal plants. While most of the manuscript is devoted to the herbal medicine of Dioscurides, there are a few shorter texts tucked into the end. This is the only illumination from a text by Rufus of Ephesus. Ancient science classified coral as a plant, so it worked with the preceding herbal. You'll see another personification like those we saw at the beginning. Down in that lower right, the sea is depicted with lobster claws, and it resembles figures of the constellation Cepheus and other manuscripts, so maybe it was pulled from an astronomical manuscript. The Vienna Dioscurides manuscript also has a paraphrase of an ornithological treatise by the ancient author named Dionysius at the end. This is the oldest treatise of its kind that survives that has an illumination of birds, so this is another reminder what a remarkable manuscript we have here. We see the bird theme carried over as well to the beautiful peacock end pages of this manuscript. The peacock end pages may have alluded to the remarkable woman, Anicia Juliana, herself. For although the church she built exists only in fragments today, we know she included peacocks in its decoration, so maybe it was sort of a signature thing for her. Through her, we have one of the most important reminders of the medieval use of medicinal plants, but also we learn from this text how scientific learning was transmitted across time and multiple cultures.